Every man who is not presumably incapacitated by some consideration of personal unfitness or of political danger is morally entitled to come within the pale of the Constitution. Of course, in giving utterance to such a proposition, I do not recede from the protest I have previously made against sudden or violent or excessive change, but I apply it with confidence to this effect, that fitness for the franchise, when it is shown to exist, is not repelled on sufficient grounds by the allegation that things are well as they are. What are the qualities which fit a man for the exercise of a privilege such as the franchise? Self-command, self-control, respect for order, patience under suffering, confidence in the law, regard for superiors. And when, I should like to ask, were all these great qualities exhibited in a manner more signal, I would even say more illustrious, than under the profound affliction of the winter of 1862? I admit the danger of dealing with enormous masses of men, but I am now speaking only of a limited portion of the working class. So far as Lancashire is concerned, we have the most extraordinary evidence of the competency of the working man to discharge those duties of retail trade and the distribution of commodities, which are commonly entrusted to the lower part of the middle class. I allude to the evidence afforded by the marvellous success in that particular county of the cooperative system. There is, in my opinion, no greater social marvel at the present day than the manner in which these societies flourish. For the bodies of men who have had recourse to the cooperative system have proved themselves to be best qualified for the discharge of the duties of independent citizens. I confess that I think the investigation into whether to extend the franchise will be far better conducted if we approach the question at an early date, in a calm frame of mind, and without having our doors besieged by crowds or our table loaded with petitions. I believe it has been given to us of this generation to witness the most blessed of all social processes. I mean the process which united together not the interests only, but the feelings of all the several classes of the community. I know of nothing which can contribute in any degree comparable to that union to the welfare of the Commonwealth. It is well, sir, that we should be suitably provided with armies and fleets and fortifications, sustained by a sound system of finance. But that which is better and more weighty still is that hearts should be bound together by a reasonable extension among selected portions of the people of every benefit and every privilege that can justly be conferred on them, and thus to the infusion of new vigour into the old, but in the best sense still young, British Constitution.